Okay, so next question. This has to do with morality and driverless cars. You made a post about these automatic driving cars. And one thing that I wanted to bring up is that I think it's interesting because in a lot of atheist Christian debates, they talk about morality. And I personally believe that because of evolution, we're going to get into a machine life. I mean, Christians like to say, like, how do you explain biological life? There was a time where there was no life whatsoever. And I believe that life emerged from non-life. And in the same way that we have biological life, it's going to someday go into artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. So I think machine life is a natural part of evolution. And I think it's fascinating, too, that they can figure out morality without appeal to God. I'll give you a chance to kind of set up this blog post or mm-hmm. what your ideas are on this. But mm-hmm. I just want to say I think it's interesting how cars and machine life basically has to make moral decisions. For example, if let's say a car is going 60 miles per hour, the Google car, and it faces a decision. Either I got to mow down 30 people because of this all of a sudden was an unexpected event here, or I'll go off to the side of the road and maybe hit three people. So 3 versus 30. I think they need to make decisions like that. And with my moral philosophy, largely based in consequentialism, it's not a big deal at all. But mm-hmm. I think it's kind of interesting for people who believe in God because they feel like these moral rules have to come from the Bible. And I don't understand why so many Christians have a problem with understanding morality without appeal to God whatsoever.
So. Okay, there are multiple issues there, and we'll probably not get to the ones you really want to talk about. I wrote driverless cars as a joke for a fun event at our church called Story Slam. And then I in the story, which is not really a story, I say, there will come a day when it's illegal to drive. And people go, oh, come on. And then I go through a little story, and it's all full of silliness about how we get to the stage where people don't get to drive anymore, and they'll arrest you if you do.
Now, because it's too dangerous.
Because it's too dangerous.
Right, yeah, because the automated cars are much safer.
Right. So the first stage is we allow there to be driverless cars. Driverless cars are being invented. I mean, there are major corporations spending much money
Apple,
on it.
Google.
They want to do this, yes. Yeah. So they will be, first they will be allowed, and then there will come a time that somebody will make a dedicated, like the HOV lane. It'll be a dedicated highway just for driverless cars. And they'll be able to go faster and more efficiently, and they'll have fewer accidents. And then once that is done and it's demonstrated, there will come a time when some state somewhere will just say, look, human drivers have to drive only on their roads. All the other roads, the great majority of the roads, are for driverless cars. And then there will come a stage when they just say, let's give it up entirely. It's just stupid. It's just selfish stupidity for people to be driving. Let the driverless cars take over. And so eventually, driverless cars everywhere. Now.
And they probably have car races, too, where the driverless cars win.
Well, they might,
because they already win at chess and Jeopardy now anyway.
I don't know about that. I think driverless car races would be incredibly boring. But
they'll skid around the corners and all that, too, just like the humans.
Well, we don't even have to wait for this. If you go to Safeco Field to watch one of the Mariner games, one of my favorite activities, I think it's during the sixth inning, they will play the stupid hydroplane race on the video board. And it's just a computer thing, but thousands of people will stand there and cheer for the yellow, blue, and red. Well, that's completely off the topic.
Yeah.
The point of the driverless cars essay is that unless I die soon, I expect to live into the period when the millions of jobs in America where people earn money by driving will disappear. And that led into my thinking about work and the future of work. Now, economists would point out that people have been inventing new ways of doing things for 10,000 years. And every time we come up with a new technology, it puts some people out of work and creates new jobs. Mm-hmm. That's true. But
in my case, I work in the computer field, and we do it because that's how we make money.
Right.
We have
right.
to sell computer chips that are more efficient.
But the point that I would make is there is a long-standing belief, and I argue that it's probably prevalent in virtually all cultures throughout human history up until the late 20th century. And that belief is that there is a moral goodness in working and a moral badness in being lazy and unproductive.
I don't know about that. I mean, I'd like to be independently wealthy.
We believe that now. But the thing is, often there have always been independently wealthy people, but they're a tiny percentage of the population. Right. What we have now is a situation that capital has become so productive that a greater and greater part of the population is able to not work, and especially not work at producing the basic goods of life.
You know, washing machines and dryers and all that stuff is definitely a lot better.
Yeah, we like life a lot better with all the things that we make.
But it takes money to buy all that stuff. We have to have a job to buy it.
Do we?
How else do you get money?
Well, more and more people do not work. Think of the millions of people in America who have retired. We think it's completely normal for people to retire. Up until 1935.
But they did work, and they worked money at one time. Retirement.
But we fool ourselves by saying, oh, they did work, so they're obeying the moral law of work. The matter of fact is, they're spending a third of their life, or in some cases a half of their life, not working. The reason this is possible is that capital is so productive, it keeps producing more and more and more goods.
But you could also say that they put money into the system and now they're drawing it out.
Okay, now the economists will call the next group of people free riders. These are people at the other end of the economic spectrum. They, in any society, such as Western Europe or North America, where you have a safety net of social services, you will have some people who come to the decision that they just prefer not to work. And so they'll live on, and so the economy calls them free riders. Mm-hmm. They're not producing, and they just live on
freeloaders, things. Yeah.
Well, notice the moral condemnation in freeloader, right? There's the moral rule that all people ought to work. That rule has been with us. You know, it's expressed by, you know, in American mythology.
But that's just a fairness thing. I mean, if people have to work for their survival, they would hold it against people who are surviving without working
and
for
that's
it. It's like,
the
why
case,
should I work if this guy doesn't
That's
have
right.
To.
That's the case of John Smith in the Jamestown colony, right? In the American mythology of the beginning of our country, you've got these wealthy English, what's the right word here? Not lords, but anyway, they don't want to work. They don't want to do physical labor. But the colony,
or something
something like that. The colony would have failed if John Smith hadn't, no relative of mine as far as I can tell, John Smith hadn't put in the rule, he that will not work will not eat. And so Jamestown is saved, right? That's our good old American moral value. We all ought to work. And it's not just an American value, it's worldwide.
Well, it's just common sense, it seems like.
You realize the power of capital to produce goods. In the future, my prediction is, in these four essays, capital will be so productive that, especially when you talk about working for necessities, food, drink, clothing, housing, it will be a privilege to work, and most people won't work at that. Even today, there are lots of people who are making very good livings producing computer games. Has nothing to do with our needs. It has to do with what we have fun with.
I don't know. I don't know if some people are making a good living. I mean, there's maybe some business owners, but there's a lot of slave programmers, I think, and a lot of them probably go out of business too, trying to compete with each other.
And some people make money off of novels, and some of us don't.
Sure. Yeah, like computer programs. Have you ever heard of Flappy Bird app?
No, never heard of it.
It kind of became a hit, and everybody started buying it, and the guy made a lot of money, but I think he said he programmed it in just like 60 hours or whatever, but then he removed it because he said it was... he thought too many people were being possessed by it or consumed by it. You know, that's all they were doing. I don't know. It doesn't make sense to me, but he made millions off it, I think.
I am not predicting that there's a future in which people won't work. People want to work because it helps fulfill their nature, I would say. And it makes for a better life.
Well, see, for
me, but they won't have to work.
Well, it depends. I mean, what I'm doing now is work because it's not something I'd really rather do. If I was independently wealthy, I would still be very active, and you would call it work, but I wouldn't call it work because I love it. I mean, like, I'd be doing shows like this.
Right.
That'd be my work, but it's not really work.
I'm intending to continue writing novels after I retire, even though there's, as I say, dozens of dollars in selling bad novels. So, you know, our time is up again.
Yeah.
Rats!
Okay. Next topic.